Good evening. I'd like to welcome all of you to the College of Complexes tonight. My name is Tim, and yes, Charlie, we are starting because we've got to get our speaker on board and ready to go. Tonight, college regular Jonathan Barton gives a review of the presidential campaign. He promises an evening of satire, solidarity, and celebrations of we the people and dreams of a better world. We have nothing to lose but our migraines. I'd like to remind the college that we have basically two rules of conduct. One, and I'm sure most of you know it, is no personal attacks. And number two, is only one fool at a time. And right now that fool is me because I have the microphone. Our format consists of the following. We have announcements, then we have our speaker, then we have a question and answer period. After the question and answer period, we have our infamous rebuttal period. Andy Anderson will be moderating tonight.
I'd like to welcome
our speaker,
Jonathan.
Before our speaker gets up here, one quick notice. We would like to encourage everybody to keep the rowdiness and the heckling down to a minimum. Let's see if we can try to have an air of civility without heckling tonight for a change. Thank you.
I'd actually prefer your heckling. I welcome it.
Okay, let's go.
No heckling.
All right, we're ready. One more round of applause for our speaker. All right.
In the words of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, I welcome your heckling, and I am proud of it, to paraphrase.
Grow a beard!
I am very humbled and thankful for this opportunity. This is not a small thing that when I suggested this topic to Tim and Charlie, that they took me up on my suggestion. And before I start, because of that, and it's Thanksgiving, I have something for both Tim and Charlie.
Come on up.
I have free packets in the back, and you can borrow a book. I won't be long on this, but I think it's a very difficult and rare art to make civics fun and empowering and to make sense in a world that is chaotic, in how we unlearn the simple art of free exchange of ideas. So I'd just like to present to both Charlie and Tim something that Slim Burdens wrote about a beatnik for president in May of 1960. This is for Tim and Charlie, for everyone's appreciation for keeping this forum one of the only ones of its kind, I believe, in the country alive. Yes. Charlie and Tim, you deserve this. Happy Thanksgiving to both of you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This is really nice.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
It's the least we can do.
But I just got thrown out. I just got thrown up.
Four more years.
Keep those incumbents.
Tonight we're going to take a road trip along the route of civics, satire, and solidarity. Let's get started. Abraham Lincoln is quoted as saying this quote that often is argued. We don't know the accuracy of whether he said this or not, but this is one of my favorite quotes by anybody. I see in the near future a crisis approaching that unnerves me, causes me to tremble for the safety of my country. Corporations have been enthroned, and an era of corruption in high places will follow. And the money power of the country will endeavor to prolong its reign by working upon the prejudices of the people until all wealth is aggregated in a few hands and the republic is destroyed. November 21st, 1864. So that's kind of a downer, but I'd like to bring something on that same subject so we don't lose sight of what Lincoln was warning us of. And I just have this song I'd like to sing for Abe.
All right.
Dance, you gotta dance
too. Oligarchy, tis of the failed state, big money, now cash is king. Land where the species die and forests can't survive. Rubber stamped ecocide, we've learned nothing. Big money, tis of the failed state, profit bullies of greed we sing. Land where the workers die and families can't get by. For your sides, what would you like? Fries, slaw, or wings? That's great. That's great. Get right into it. Welcome to the 2016 Electoral Migraine. If you have a packet, you know that inside it we have a mini guide to some of the characters of this year's presidential race. So let's start with the top of the left side with the caboose. The one percenters. The oligarchy lords, privatization bosses, plutocracy bullies, the filthy effing rich. We can't see them, but they're in there. The world that they know is kind of like a building that's two or three stories high above ground, but 30 or 40 stories below ground. There's a whole lot of things that they have to hide. These are the Donald Trumps, the Mitt Romneys, the Charles and David Kochs, the Walton family, Ken Griffin, Michael Bloomberg, Sheldon Adelson, the Pritzker family, Carl Icahn, Rupert and James Murdoch, Roger Ailes, Bruce Rauner, Lloyd Blankfein, Jamie Dimon, Diane Hendricks, Tom Barrack, the Mercer family, Woody Johnson, Ray Washburn, Andy Beal, Art Pope, just to name a few. The millionaire-billionaire class are an elitist, embarrassingly wealthy group who are really, really active in manipulating outcomes of elections, waging wars of aggression, destabilizing the economy, slashing human service funding, narrowing independent voices on public airwaves, redistricting, backing totalitarian regimes, polluting the air, sea, and land, and more. Why do they do it? Well, insecurity, maybe, ignorance, maybe, immaturity, pride, anger, hatred, greed, mostly greed. In order to quench their never-ending, never-satisfied thirst for power and influence, they have wreaked havoc, unleashing the system's claws and fangs on us to such extremes that their organizations make global cartels envious. They are dangerous. They roll into our communities on an overwhelming wave of money with one goal in mind: global hegemony, dominance over every single life and resource. And that's the one percenters, so happy to start off on a note there. The next one is the dupes. Members of the community who are easily manipulated into voting for candidates and supporting policy against their own interests, who, despite their economic struggles of high unemployment and underemployment, bizarrely continue to believe in the lie of Reaganism, Thatcherism, trickle-down economics, pro-deregulation ideology. They are fanatically anti-union, anti-democratic socialism, jingoist, classist, racist, misogynist, nativist, abilityist, and xenophobic. And no matter how much worse their quality of life gets as opportunities in their neighborhoods diminish, they still loyally support corporatist, militarist, surveillancist, prison-expanding, eco-siding candidates. They are like a person who chooses an idea that has a lot of red flags around it before thinking it through and reflecting if the cost equals the real value of what they're agreeing with. just like a consumer getting a used car that looks like the most worn out vehicle on the entire lot without bothering to get an opportunity to observe the quality of the engine, the condition of the brakes, and the overall product without taking a test drive to confirm that it's not a ripoff. They're not the village idiots, just the 21st century dupes. And as baffling as it appears to other industrialized nations, when faced with a choice between the two, in essence, a F-minus or an F-plus candidate, members in desperate communities where all the quality unemployment opportunities were removed decades ago often decide to collectively de-evolve and elect the F-minus party. They are the dupes.
The dupes.
And the next card is Brucey, otherwise known as the governor of Illinois, Bruce Rauner. Appropriately, he is sitting on one of the farthest seats from where the work is happening. He's always glowing his trademark Grinch-like grin, as is often the case with the inside-the-bubble-of-luxury types. He doesn't catch on that he's infamous, not famous, and that's an important distinction. He's in Springfield, Illinois, not from a noble and diligent noteworthy achievement. It's because he bought his way into power. He purchased his current position, and his governor has forced the most anti-worker, anti-union, anti-disability community, and public education policies in the history of the state. He spouts nonsense about how we the people need to learn to make more out of less wages while he continues tax breaks for the ultra-rich. One of the most expensive inaugurations in recent history, and now he's decided to approve a very costly renovation of his mansion. It's a tough life that Brucey is living. Mark chapter 8 verse 36 reads, "What shall it benefit someone who gains the world yet forfeits one's soul?" It's a very good question to ask those who support this fool. Next is Ted Cruz, Crazy Cruzy. Senator Ted Cruz of Texas, a 2016 presidential candidate, if you can believe it. In September 24th, 1913, he chose an interesting topic to talk about on the Senate floor. During a fake filibuster session, the fundamentalist wingnut took valuable time to talk at great length, not about climate change or full funding for disability community services or job training programs, not about repealing Citizens United Supreme Court ruling or eliminating student debt or ending mass surveillance or infrastructure renewal. No, no. Instead, Crazy Cruzy decided to read the classic transcending book by Dr. Seuss, Green Eggs and Ham. Just one example of the high level of respect the senator from the Lone Star State has for his constituents' time, trust, and taxes. The shocking thing is he just almost became the Republican Party's 2016 pick for President of the United States of America.
That's because Green Eggs and Ham's a good book.
That's exactly right. Next is the Bush clan. George H.W. Bush, President number 41 from 89 to 93. Vice President from 81 to 89 under that B actor hack. Former head of CIA, George W. President, number 43, with an asterisk, thanks to the Supreme Court and Catherine Harris and his brother Jeb. And former owner of the Texas Rangers baseball team. And of course, Jeb Bush, former governor of Florida. A political dynasty in Connecticut, Florida, Texas, and wherever else on earth there happens to be an unjust war happening, or oil, or water, or narcotics, or cheap labor. You can see the manic, you look closely, the manic look in the eyes are a sure sign of many years of heavy alcohol and narcotics abuse by W. The blood red exterior indicates what are the final outcomes of the operations of the Central Intelligence Agency from Daddy Georgie. Now, for most organized crime rings, hegemony is next to godliness. But for the CIA, they already assume that they've reached the status of God. So the saying loses a lot of its charm. W has some of the most complicated travel restrictions of any former U.S. president due to the high amount international legal groups, human rights groups, yes, faith organizations, and governments who are willing to charge him with crimes against humanity, yes, and have him brought before the International Criminal Court for violations normally charged against despots, extremists, warlords, and cartel bosses. He spends a lot of his time in Crawford, Texas, painting and praying and pondering why a letter from the Nobel Peace Prize Committee hasn't come in the mailbox yet. There was a famous incident when W. visited Iraq, and at a press conference, a man in the audience spontaneously stood up and threw his shoe at him in righteous anger. Some of you might remember this beautiful people power moment. Domestically, memory of how many international laws were ignored and broken by W's administration is weak. However, all around the world, masses of people who are struggling to survive the aftermath and escape the results of the war on terror remember. That's the Bush clan. Next is Donald Trump, billionaire real estate mogul, slumlord, hotel casino owner, suit and tie bank robber, full-time misogynist reality TV show jackass. Anything that he has to say consists of the exact same substance that is found in the sound of a goose or a duck wildly squawking. Just watch his speeches with the sound muted and then tape a couple of post-it notes on your television screen with a kind of a cartoon bubble with the words quack, 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 and you will get the gist of whatever he's raving on about. There is a list of lawsuits filed against Trump for wages owed for past labor that are probably higher than this hat if you stack them up. He's the poster child for the two very different experiences with the law in the U.S. There's one brand of treatment for the pampered, privileged, spoiled, wealthy members, and another brand of treatment for the austerity-eyed working-class members. He is sometimes a wolf in sheep's clothing, sometimes a wolf in wolf's clothing, sometimes a dragon in wolf's clothing, and sometimes an oligarchic extinctionist in Gordon Gekko's three-piece suit. Donnie's just the tip of the iceberg of what the global elite are willing to do to maintain their power. The 1% will literally pick a fascist reality TV personality to keep their good gig going. Wow. Yeah. 50 national security experts who said they had worked previously for Republican presidents, including 24 who had jobs at the White House National Security Council, signed an actual joint letter declaring Trump unqualified and that they would put he would put the country's security at risk, no doubt, were he to be inaugurated as president. They further said he had dangerous personal qualities and called him ignorant of U.S. laws and vital national interests. They said he clearly lacks the temperament to be president. So that's what we have to look forward to, Americans. Fellow United Statesians, this is a great moment in history. Why great? I can't exactly articulate. It's inexplicable, and you'll hear me say the word inexplicable a lot this evening. PolitiFact, a fact-checking website, awarded Trump the 2015 Lie of the Year Award for a series of false statements. During one time where he spoke, the site rated 76 of 77 Trump statements, mostly false, false, or pants on fire false. He raised approximately $255 million, depending on what source you go to, for his 2016 campaign, and spent $66 million of his own money on his campaign. So good for him. Next is Karl Rove, neoconservative strategist, advisor, and lapdog of George W. Bush, unofficial code named Turd Blossom, one of the architects of the 2000 stolen election in Florida with help from Jeb Bush and Catherine Harris, as previously mentioned. Rove specializes in voter disenfranchisement, redistricting, gerrymandering, and teaches young neocon propagandists how to be successful reactionary spin operatives. In the magic tricks that he demonstrates every election season, the truth becomes irrelevant and the lie becomes the new accepted truth. He's lurking somewhere behind the curtain whenever and wherever there's another opportunity for him and his ilk to treat the American citizenry like we are less than nothing. Writing revisionist history is a scoundrel's profession, and through the art of BSing his way to Washington, he's reached the level of influence and wealth that makes the ghost of Joseph Goebbels wish he had been alive in the Bush administration's staff. When you wrap fascism in a flag and put a big cross up in front, you basically have the coat of arms for what he's all about. Manipulating public opinion so severely that the masses of people vote against their own interests. Next one is our own Burgermeister, Meister Burger, Rom. He's the former White House, he's just adorable. Former White House Chief of Staff of the Obama administration, former investment banker, and also former fundraiser for the Clinton White House. The late great Mayor Harold Washington is up there in the Elysium Fields somewhere, sitting alongside other Chicago greats such as Gwendolyn Brooks, Jane Addams, Carl Sandburg, Nelson Algren, Curtis Mayfield, Emmett Till, Muhammad Ali, John Belushi, Fred Hampton, Studs Terkel, Frank Lloyd Wright, and they're all just shaking their heads in disbelief, witnessing the current, "We will give you all the details of the plans at the next press conference if there's any time for it," current governing style of the mayor. He's a rapid-fire cuss word tantrum behavior, which he's famous for. It's odd to see someone who has such contempt for everyday people, yet chooses to be in the center of the spotlight of the media. He once had a shouting match with Chicago Teachers Union President Karen Lewis, very famous incident, that was described as an F-bomb tour de force. He also once called the very voters who elected him when demanding he support progressive public policy because it would improve quality of life and would also generate revenue that they were effing retarded. What a people's mayor. Most likely he will leave as soon as possible to go back somewhere to Washington. After he's corporatized Chicago into a miserable state of mass unemployment, unaccountable tax dodgers of the LaSalle District, mass gentrification, defunding of public education, and hyper-privatization. He's an anti-New Deal progressive. This is what a Democrat in name only looks like. The next one is the National Security Agency, another favorite of mine. Big ears, always listening. Big eyes, always watching. Big trunk, sniffing around everywhere in all our lives, violating basic human liberties and privacy rights of a civilized society with a casual attitude that is so shameless as if to say, how can we not snoop around where there's most likely nothing? When our agency is this massive, we might as well put those squandered tax dollars to good use and create a file for all 320 million of them.
Yeah.
When all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. When all your time and energy goes into assuring the people's taxes make a giant mass surveillance agency, everyone must be a potential terrorist. It's not personal, it's just profit. Edward Snowden, on a side note, your integrity and your brave action in pulling the alarm on treasonous behavior of U.S. administrations, Congress, military contractors, surveillance and intelligence agencies is revered and taken more to our hearts, voices, and deeds by countless every day. Love and respect to you. We dream of a day when the U.S. is a place you can return for a true hero's welcome.
Yeah.
Thank you on this Thanksgiving, Edward Snowden. Next one, Fox News. Alias Dumbing Down America Live, alias Fixed Noise, alias Batshit Crazy Broadcasting Station, alias Fascist Network, The Fool Channel, Infotainment Tonight, Orwell's Worst Nightmare TV, and my favorite, Effed Up News. So with that in mind, can we all say all together just one? F you, Fox News, on the count of three. One, two, three. Yeah. F you, Fox News. You all have natural singing quality skills. And not that far off are all the other bullhorns of madness who are pro-Patriot Act, pro-Iraq War, pro-tax breaks for the rich, pro-fossil fuel industry, pro-media privatization. CNN, MSNBC, CBS, WGN, NBC, ABC, all the ones we love and adore over the years. The Wall Street Journal, the Chicago Tribune, the Daily Herald, the Chicago Sun-Times, the Washington Post, the New York Times, and a long list of many others. Corporate media is the opium of the masses, to steal part of a quote from Chairman Mao Zedong, at least for those who choose not to ever visit their local library. Next is the youth community. The youth community and the young adult community are independent-minded, fearless, and creative, and have raw solidarity, revolutionary cooperation, and soul power. Neoliberalism is constantly exploiting the youth in order to generate maximum profit, no matter the human costs, the peace costs, or the earth costs. In order to have faith in the future, we dedicate all our time, energy, to nurturing the youth community, supporting their struggles, and we need to be ready and present for their ideas and to follow their lead. We remember the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, brilliant efforts of leadership in the civil rights movement. It's an important lesson for today's grassroots struggles to take to heart. Solidarity with the youth. Trust the youth. They will surprise you with their work ethic and their willingness to serve justice. Next is Hillary Clinton. She's in the yellow there on the bottom. Senator of New York from 2001 to 2009, first spouse. I haven't ever said first spouse in a public speaking engagement ever, so this is a new opportunity. Of the United States from 1993 to 2001, Secretary of State under the Obama administration, one of Washington, D.C.'s most well-known anti-New Deal progressives. Donors to her 2016 presidential campaign include Saudi Arabia, Victor Pinchuk, Cheryl and Haim Sabin, S. Abraham, Kuwait, Coca-Cola, Nasser al-Rashid, Boeing, Anheuser-Busch, the Zaid family, Dow Chemical, Blues Allen Hamilton, ExxonMobil, Goldman Sachs, Friends of Saudi Arabia, James Murdoch, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, Walmart, Chevron, Citigroup, Bank of America, News Corp, Monsanto, of course, and TransCanada Canadian Foreign Affairs Trade and Development. Now that's a long name, so I don't exactly know what they do, but it has something to do with trade and development. It's a list of groups who every year have lawsuits brought against them for acts of theft, waste, fraud, abuse, classism, murder, torture, repression, sham elections, media censorship, and ecocide. She loves to brag that Henry Kissinger is her good friend. And she's got that primetime ready, billion-dollar, I'm on top of the world, euphoric expression all the time. And with such bright, brilliant, absolutely adorable Goldman Sachs golden feathers. This is what a War Hawk and Dove's clothing looks like. Priceless. She raised $510 million for the 2016 campaign. I don't know how much you add that to the 2008, but that's a lot of money none of us will ever have. Next one is Debbie Does Democracy Wasserman Schultz, the congresswoman from Florida, former chair of the Democratic National Committee. She was ousted, thanks to a great investigative journalist at WikiLeaks.
She's a good looker, though.
What's that?
She's a good looker, though.
Well, we all, you know.
Former news anchor.
We were glad she prospered to the point where she had, you know, a good life. So, you know, we don't wish her ill will. Just stay away from the DNC for the rest of your life. Caught as the top overseer of the sabotaging and undermining of Senator Bernie Sanders' 2016 presidential campaign, one of the most successful political fundraising efforts in history, with an average Sanders donation just under $30, showing a clear interest amongst massive of the public in grassroots issues such as overturning Citizens United's Supreme Court ruling, the worst Supreme Court ruling ever, transitioning elections and campaigns to public financing, as well as free media time for candidates, along with full disclosure of all candidates' donors. My personal favorite on Bernie's list is breaking up the banks. Schultz gave a whole new generation of crystal clear understanding of the nefarious deal-making ways of the cronies, cartels, and creeps of the Washington, D.C. establishment. She was immediately given a job with the Clinton campaign after being exposed for the shameful attempts to discredit Bernie supporters as foolish, pie-in-the-sky college kids and closet misogynists, and Bernie as a naive and an anti-Affordable Care Act crazy old commie from Vermont, which is of course laughable since Senator Sanders helped write the ACA. Next one is the Kool-Aid kids. There are Kool-Aid drinkers, Kool-Aid-aholics, Kool-Aid fiends, Kool-Aid divers, and then there's this lot. Those who never question authority, never research history, never review the record, never visit the library or bookstore, never are skeptical of the popular narrative, never call out hypocrisy, never take a stand, never speak up, never take action, and don't any use for dissent, disagreement, or democracy, because for them it's just words. They obediently go along and don't rock the boat.
Ooh, that's all right.
And they shame others who do rock the boat. They think of democracy as just a sound to recite at an Independence of July cookout or a Fireworks Day parade, not as a way to achieve equality or cooperation or coexistence, or to build a livable future. It's a prop to decorate the scenery. Those of us who are fortunate enough to have an inner tube or maybe a life vest of economic opportunity to stay afloat know full well we don't have a boat to rock, and that's why we rock the water and everything in it. We're headed for the civic equivalent of the edge of the waterfall, and those of us who don't wear the blindfold and prefer to not insert the earplugs are loudly speaking up before it's too late. Don't foul fools over the falls. Don't let a failed system become a failed soul. Don't support oligarchy. Don't drink the Kool-Aid. It's bright and it's sweet, and the commercial insists that you'll be so happy and fulfilled if you have a cup, but it'll never make anybody free. Especially not the me, because the me can never be free. There is no me. There are lots of different languages and ages and abilities and colors and voices and ideas of we. Solidarity is a concept that our imaginations have the capacity to strive for and reach when we stop being me and leap forward as we. Give us your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, the tempest-tossed, to we. We lift our lamps beside the golden door. Next is the engine, neoliberalism. Vulture-nomics, vampire-nomics.
Jonathan, can I bring it around? Can I bring around people?
Of course, it's painted red and blue to symbolize the two-party system's obedience to it. Everywhere it goes, it spawns pain and suffering. The engine is like the Grim Reaper kind of force which leads all of us off the cliff of austerity until we don't know how we just let it happen. Because we landed so fast, so hard, we just feel lucky to be few of us on Earth who lived past the last collapse, which introduced the next chapter of insanity when the powers that imposed another list of new normals that we the people strongly oppose. It's possible that we are nearing a crucial fork in the road, that we are all thinking the same thing. When it comes to the current dominant global system, we have nothing to lose but our chains. The analysis by Marx is maybe another way of saying we are humans, not lemmings. It's a long overdue that we commit our lives to something greater than the limitations of today's world, that we fully exercise our self-generated energies, our souls. The system we are subjected to living in does not and has not ever lived in us. What lives in us are beautiful dreams of another world, too many to count. Now, what demographic of the United States do any of you think the tracks might represent?
Generation X.
Close.
The baby boomers.
Close. It's everyone who sees that their economic opportunities not only are less than their parents and their grandparents, but are non-existent. Basically, we the working class and middle class community members, who are constantly run over by the dominant system. Each time they get over on us, we don't hear the metallic screeching sound train tracks make, just silence. And we feel empty and used, exhausted, betrayed, lied to, misled, suckered, furious, and ready for real change. We know it doesn't have to be like this. We don't have to tolerate living in communities where our every moment is run by caricatures. Clichés and cartoons that are so incompetent, so greedy, and so completely failed that they can't speak a single sentence without a teleprompter. We can be the better world we know we are born to be. All we need to do is organize. So the choice in 2016, for those of us who are lucky enough to have a local polling place, which meets our accessibility and public transportation needs, can take a half a day off of work, are legally allowed to cast our votes, are given the correct ballot, and whose votes are accurately counted, the choice is still no choice at all. Now imagine if our political lives are just as important to us as our nutritional health when we go to the grocery store. Our choices on the ballot can be compared to the policy platform's value, just like food can be graded for their nutritional value. For example, Jeb Bush, Ted Cruz, Mike Huckabee, Marco Rubio, Dr. Ben Carson, Scott Walker, Chris Christie, Rick Perry, bless their hearts. Any of these is the electoral equivalent of suicide.
Oh, I like
a negative amount of democracy. It's actually below zero, if you can conceptualize that. Next one is Don Trump. This is an electoral equivalent of going to the store and deciding when you see everything that's there that you mindlessly want to purchase opium, cocaine, beer, Red Bull, bacon, and cheese. Absolutely no democracy value at all. And there's Hillary Clinton. This is the electoral equivalent of going to the store and obediently purchasing opium, cocaine, beer, Red Bull, bacon, cheese, one apple, and some ice cream. Extremely little to no democracy value. But in an honest analysis, slightly better or less evil than Donald Trump. So I concede that. The next one, exactly, apple and ice cream. Next one is Gary Johnson. This is the electoral equivalent of going to the store. Now, this store is special because the video camera footage in the grocery store will never be available to anyone without a proper warrant, and that is an honorable thing, issued from a judge who is appointed by the majority of the community members. And purchasing whatever you want without any consequences, as long as there happens to be no war, poverty, disabilities, or hunger, illiteracy, homelessness, old age, healthcare needs, community infrastructure needs, unemployment, pollution, or happens to life or a direct family member's life, or impacts the community you live in. So under the most ideal conditions, this would still only have a Hail Mary pass chance of success. So a little bit of democracy value. Jill Stein. This is the electoral equivalent of consciously purchasing vegetables and fruits, fish and tofu, turkey and chicken, soups, rice, beans, nuts, noodles, bread, spices, yogurt, eggs, cheese, milk, juice, coffee, beans, water, wine, beer, low sugar, low sodium, sweets, and snacks. Strong democracy value.
Yuck!
That is to say, yuck. I know it's not as exciting or sexy, I concede that.
Yuck!
That is to say, if the public knows that those things are the market even exists, since they are hidden far away in a loft area, way at the end of the most elusive spot of the building, sadly most voters don't know about the Green Party or its values, due to the conscious exclusion of third-party alternatives imposed by the Commission on Presidential Debates. Now, if you know the history behind these jokers, they took it away from the League of Women Voters. And so basically, it's our party, you're not invited. Land of the free, home of the brave. Land where only two choices can be at the debates. The Green Party has a Hail Mary pass chance of success in this year's presidential race, and that's true, but it gives working class communities as well as middle class communities opportunities to organize around grassroots issues and will be strong parts of the public's demands of all candidates once they're in office in future elections. So that's a noteworthy achievement, and I give them that. Last season in professional football, there was a successful Hail Mary pass. I believe it was Green Bay at Detroit. So every once in a while, a Hail Mary pass does happen, yeah. You know, very difficult, rare things can possibly happen. It's not impossible, just extraordinarily rare. You have to have a great group of people, which we, the United Statesians, do have. And everybody has to show up to do the work, which I think we have that capacity as well. We may not always exercise it, but we certainly have the capacity. The fact is that we don't need to choose between F- and F+ choices for local, state, federal, public office. We are an A people, and as such, we deserve A solutions to make the law of the land. We the people, with the technology of social media amongst many, don't need to suggest or request or beg for justice to be granted or negotiated for. We can peacefully and democratically mass mobilize to take power and enact justice ourselves. The dreams we are alive for, unite for, and fight for determine our capacity to evolve into an enlightened, civilized world. Communities of peace, equality, love, liberation, transparency, justice, respect, and protection of Mother Earth, and solidarity. That's the future. A movement in which we the people declare our autonomy from fascism, communism, and neoliberalism, from tyranny, violence, and hate, from division, from fear, from secrecy, from deception, from oppression, from exploitation, from pollution, and from ecocide. Disobey the dream limit. And happy 2016 electoral migraine, America.
Yes,
that's
sir.
My talk.
Don't rock the boat.
Where's
the moderator?
All right, you're okay. First question. Considering that Chicago just recently had, as everybody knows, a World Series victory by the Chicago Cubs, what principles could you extract from them with their success on your political views?
Oh, man. Well, they're a winner. They're a winner, so, you know. I believe in winners by the scoreboard of ideas, not by the scoreboard of money. I've lost the whole entire time I've been alive on Earth on the scoreboard of money. I've lost. But on the scoreboard of ideas, I've been a winner, and I believe the Cubs and their fan base exemplify not just winning on the field, but off the field. Excellent question.
Okay. Andy, let's get up there to moderate. Go ahead and take your next one.
Yes, sir.
Jonathan, I wasn't exactly sure who you supported for the election.
Well, isn't it obvious? I support We the People.
We the People.
Yes, I do, and that is an actual candidate choice as well. It's not often told to us by the media, but it is a choice.
Did you actually vote?
Yes, I did. I voted for what would have been the first female president of the United States, and sadly, she got about 1% of the vote.
Oh.
I see.
But I did vote down ballot for what I perceive to be progressive candidates who actually won. So I'm not an absolutist. I don't think that that solves anything. I don't want to tear down the whole house just because one room has excrement all over it. But I do feel very strongly that the people who have, made our public commons a joke of the rest of the industrialized world have committed treason, and as such, we have to take necessary action.
Okay, next
question.
You paraphrased, you said Mao with okay to the masses?
Yes.
Did you not mean Marx?
I believe Mao said that opium, religion is the opium of the masses. But that might have been attributed to Marx as well. They might have both had that view and worded it in different ways.
One comment is as good as the next.
If Gary Johnson had won the presidency, which kind of boggles the mind, but who would you think he would have chosen for Secretary of State? Obviously, he didn't have a lot of knowledge in that area. What do you think he would?
Who else would thank him?
Well, if one is a libertarian and has that worldview and is considering the next Secretary of State, someone who basically is the person who facilitates relations between the United States and other nations, your guess is as good as mine. Gary Johnson is kind of a wild card. He isn't the establishment, so there's really no way of predicting that. It's a great question, and I'm happy to say it's the answer that I search along with you.
Thank you.
Since Trump was once a Democrat just a couple years ago, do you think he'll eventually...
Well, he can be anything he wants at any given moment. In the mind of Trump, this is, a very, very nebulous thing where you concretely stand.
Do you think he'll eventually turn state far right or will turn left?
As far as public policy from a national level?
Everything, yeah.
It's hard to predict. He's cast himself as an outsider. He's cast himself as a independent, self-made entity. He's cast himself as someone who's for the everyday person. Of course, that everyday person at his rallies always happens to be non-disabled, gainfully employed or much more employed than other members of the community, white males, who I don't blame people for not knowing what they don't know when our corporate media is so failed. I know they are suffering from 35 years of Reaganism, and they couldn't believe that a Republican was actually saying things like the Iraq War was a total failure and that we need to bring jobs home. I think they just enjoyed hearing that from a Republican for the first time, I believe, since Eisenhower, in a way that at least in his delusional, warped delivery sounded plausible to them. But I still believe that those people who voted for him are not stupid, and I'd just like to get that on record. They're people who have been devastated. And if the media tells them that you can choose F minus or F plus, well, you know, they're not thinking along those lines. They're thinking along those lines is they need a job because they're at the end of their survival rope. And I feel that. I feel that for them, and I don't fault them for going to an extreme position. At least extreme from their standpoint, not so extreme as Bernie Sanders. But this is what I think about, you know, what if they just said, what's the worst thing could happen for 4 years of a democratic socialist like Bernie Sanders was president? I think the things that he was promising would actually have been enacted into law instead of just campaign promises. So I just feel more confidence in Bernie's campaign dialogue with his voters than Trump, because Trump, he's a guy who he'll say what he has to say to get what he wants to get. And if tomorrow he changed his mind, well, that's just the way the type of billionaire that he is thinks and works and operates.
Why didn't you bring up right-wing radio more? That's what got him elected. Trump elected.
Yeah, we have a lot of hate radio problems in this country, which I think now have come to the fore. Our media is very, very, it unifies people in identifying the other as a cause to be very pro-jingoist about, and identifying the perceived problem of our economic ills as the target instead of ones that we should build bridges and alliances with. So it's a very dangerously similar rhetoric to what we heard in Europe in the 1930s.
Okay.
Yeah, you kind of answered my question. You said initially that the people at Trump rallies were people who were, you seem to imply, a little better off. I think actually the opposite is true, which you kind of ended up with, that they're people who maybe were in good shape at one time but are not now. They seem to be very much worried about their future, not doing well economically, which incidentally I think are also who a lot of the Bernie Sanders voters were.
So what's your question?
So my comment on that. Actually, he kind of answered part of it.
The economic status of the people who showed up to vote this year, and why their economic status led them in one direction of a candidate or the other?
Well,
they don't make $15 an hour. We know that. And according to production, actually, Americans should be making $20 an hour if we're going to have radical economic justice, paycheck justice, if you like to call it that. So we have a lot of desperate people who have been surviving the aftermath of supply-side economics. And it's not just supply-side economics by the Republicans. This is a bipartisan sickness that they've inflicted on their constituencies. And we've seen the result. People are so at their wits' end that they'll vote for a proto-fascist.
Sir, I missed it. Did you say which character was Bernie Sanders? I missed it.
Well, I consider Bernie to be a bona fide born leader and not a cartoon, and that's the reasoning why I omitted him from... There's a lot of things in the packet about Bernie and quoting Bernie, and I actually have this book, Outsider in the White House, here available for anyone who'd like to borrow it. It's an amazing thing when young people are talking about socialism the way they talk about socialism in the rest of the industrialized world. It's been undemonized, and that is, along with the fact that the Trans-Pacific Partnership was defeated, the victory, and to me, the true story of 2016 is Bernie Sanders.
What lessons are there for the Democratic and Republican parties?
I don't think that's their main skill of reflecting and learning from their mistakes. I think they double down very good, and they have an excellent skill and strength at tripling down and quadrupling down and five oopling down at math be damned, history be damned, facts be damned thought process. It's what makes them who they are. They do pick on the little guy and are proud of it. And it's a very, very sad thing to see when people can't go to a rally without getting punched in the face, because that's where civility has de-evolved to as a result of the dangerous rhetoric. But to answer your question more specifically, I think the Republican and Democratic parties are losing members to the Green Party and the Libertarians and Democratic Socialists like Shauna Sawant, City Councilwoman in Seattle, and different movements that speak to the community's needs without market values, but with human values in mind and prioritized. So what happens is you have an entire new generation that does not see any future in the Republican and Democratic Party, which is sad because I think Dwight Eisenhower and Franklin Delano Roosevelt are two people who they deserve better than this. They busted their ass to build these two parties, and it's been corporatized to death by corporate thieves, corporate murderers, and corporate ecociders. I mean, they can't even be called polluters. There's so extreme pollution, it's ecocide. It's bringing us to the brink of extinction. So I think the two parties, it's a sad situation that we all have to just be as constructive as possible, because this really is the end of the line for those two parties. I think it's the two-party system is done officially this year. I think they're losing young people rapidly.
Bob?
How many millions of people does it take to have like one electoral vote? Population, you know, like California has like 55.
Illinois has 20.
Yeah. So how does, what's the ratio there of people? I know it's two for, you know, the it's two senators, and then it's one for so many millions of population, I guess, equivalent to the House of Representatives. What is that number?
That I can't answer. I don't know. I do know that Trump got approximately 60,710,404 votes, so 47.2% of the electorate. Clinton got 61,583,300, so 47.9% of the electorate. And there were a lot of people in the country who weren't aware that the Electoral College was the way that we count our votes in this country, because it's so ridiculously backwards. I mean, when you go to the cash register at the store and they ask you for $3, you give them $3. You don't give them, you know, what you feel is $3, because that's the amount you have. So it just feels like we're living in a bizarre parallel universe where up is down and down is up. But to answer your question, I'd have to look that up on the web, and if you come next week, I'd be glad to talk to you further, because I think it's a great question.
Charlie, yeah, your hand up.
Yeah, you mentioned there, We the People, I guess that's your name, that Donald Trump was inaccurate 76 out of 77 times. Do you think he was lying, or do you think he just didn't know? And I use this expression on occasion. He didn't know what he was talking about. Or three, do you think he was just saying what people, I guess you call them dupes, wanted to hear and would vote for?
I used to be one of those people, so it's not a pejorative as far as I'm concerned. Well, we all can be duped.
Saying things just so that people would vote for him. He didn't care if it.
I think he's a major operator. He's very clever. He knows how to present himself in a way that probably is very different behind closed doors. But what that different way exactly is behind closed doors is anybody's guess. He's coming from a world of real estate, of casinos, of golf courses, of, you know, go on, take the money and run, basically. He has a lot of revenge in him. If you read David K. Johnston's book about Trump, I believe it's called The Making of Trump. He was on Democracy Now! At least twice in the last month. If you check it out, that's a great, great interview show. He has a lot of George W. in him and a lot of Nixon in him, only he has no filter. So when he wants to let the acceptable target have it from the podium, he'll do it. And, you know, all those intelligence and agencies that wrote that letter that said he just does not appear to be fit to be a statesman for the most powerful country in the world, I think we're right on the money. He lacks emotional intelligence, and I think it's very sad, because if you want to have an armchair psychologist perspective of it, I think he was severely abused either in boarding school or military school. He's always identifying women as objects, as a way of presenting himself as a fearless leader to be seen by other males as somehow a conqueror, and he likes to sue people, and he likes to tell people he will sue them if he hasn't sued them yet. And there's a lot of court cases where they haven't released what was the agreement, because he's got so much money he can run the little guy in town out of the time allotted for the case. So I mean, like when the guys in New York, the immigrant workers from Poland, were saying that they didn't get fair wages and were treated to terrible working conditions, you know, living in squalor when they were promised, you know, living conditions, temporary worker conditions that we would all expect for anyone, whether they're immigrants or born in the United States. His attitude was, well, let's just see how long you last with me in court. I'm a billionaire. That's the compassion level that you will see in a Donald Trump on a consistent basis throughout his career.
To answer your question, I'm pretty sure the Electoral College is the entire congressional delegation. Two senators for every state, plus the number of congressmen they have, which is based on population.
Yeah, I just wonder what that number was. How many? About 600,000.
About
600,000. Oh, 600,000. Okay, because I had a part two to my question, and that is, do you think it's fair that illegal aliens are counted as population in appropriation of the electoral vote? Slaves only got 3/5 of the person. We're counting illegal aliens as 5/5 of the person to distribute electoral votes. So you get somebody like Clinton, you come in there to the, you know, just appeal to the large Democratic cities in the country, you know, the coastal, Chicago, New York, L.A., and really, you know, you can win 11 states and you can win the...
Yeah, give me a minute, I got to make more.
With the electoral votes you have in sanctuary cities like Chicago, New York, L.A.
Yeah, I don't know if the international monitoring bodies of other countries in the United Nations would say about our voting system as far as the ways that the Diebold machines can be so easily manipulated. I don't know what they would say about our long lines, and I think it was possibly over 800 less polling places in 2016 than 2014. So yeah, I think what you're asking is important, but on the scale of things that could make our country collapse from within or not, I see it as a problem when people are afraid to go vote because they just got their citizen status, and disinformation has been either directly or indirectly given to them that they shouldn't go vote, because that can be taken away from them just for voting for someone who happens to be in that community, not the majority. That's happening in America. It's been documented in several news outlets. People are afraid to vote. And if we're going to be the place that goes into places in the last 15 years, like Afghanistan and Iraq and Pakistan, and be the model for democracy, is it any wonder that then what we see them emulating is a system that results in despots and warlords. Our voting system is broken, and we the people did not break it. A very small group of wealthy, powerful, influential people took it to where it is. I won't even say take it away, because that harkens back to some imaginary day that never existed where everyone could vote. The American voting history, election history, if you read Charles Dickens, he has a famous quote on this, where I'm paraphrasing, you know, he said that the newspapers and the hired pens and the writers were just downright the lowest, most despicable manipulators and propagandists you could have. And it was just a mockery of an actual fair count and fair inclusion and welcoming of all members of the community. I don't feel like when I vote, I can guarantee that my vote is counted. It's a feel-good exercise, basically, in this country, to me, from my perspective.
Why did the media and the pollsters get it so wrong? Why did we do such a bad job predicting the outcome of the election?
Well, they reside in a place otherwise known as the Beltway. So that's my answer. They don't go out to middle class or working class communities because that's not on their agenda. They wanna, they're stenographers. You know, this is a cliche, but they are stenographers. We hear this said all the time in constructive critique of what our media has devolved into. They have the power literally to make people think that their economic quality of life will increase if they have a casino real estate mogul who knows nothing about governing, knows nothing about public policy negotiating, knows nothing about international relations and diplomacy and finding common ground on issues that are important to represent we the people of the United States in a positive way to the rest of the world as a leader and a member of a sane policy. So I'm very, very hopeful that it'll ignite grassroots mobilization in all these organizations like Jane Addams Senior Caucus, the environmental movements like 350.org, Black Lives Matter, organizations for disability rights, organizations for workers' rights, of course, and organizations that basically say we want to be a civilization and not a cage.
Can I add one thing to that for her? Also, to answer Corinne's question, one of the reasons that the pollsters got so far wrong was that the pollsters, the exit pollsters were reporting who voted and how they voted, and the totals were way off. They didn't match the official count. The reason that the pollsters' count didn't match the official count the next day was they changed the vote totals with the electronic machines to install Trump after 2 o'clock in the morning. Of course, the exit polls aren't going to match because the exit polls reported the real count of who voted while they shifted it to the right. There's overwhelming evidence of this by computer experts all over the country. So we have to stop thinking that we elected Trump. We didn't. They installed Trump with shifting enough Republican votes in certain key states to put him in. By matter.
So you're saying that this vote shifting was done, was this done by Americans or was this done with the help of Russian hands?
No, it had Russians had nothing to do with it. This was done by Karl Rove's dirty trick squad. I was just reading today, in 2013, they gutted the Voting Rights Act. And the Supreme Court, this is the first major election where we didn't have a Voting Rights Act at all. So Karl Rove's minions have been doing dirty tricks all over the country to disenfranchise poor people, brown people, people that aren't rich white Americans. It's because brown people and people of color vote against white racist politicians. Hey, take it easy.
We're all brethren.
I told you
we're all brethren.
There is no heckling.
We're all brethren. Quiet down. We are brethren of the sanctuary of Slim Brundage.
Do you got a question, Charlie?
Yeah. Ever since the elections were announced, these ne'er-do-wells
have been marching up and down the street. They had a big one downtown today. Do you think they're paid for? Like they say, they're getting like $15 an hour.
Oh, please, John.
Who's made that claim? Who's made
that Fox News and other reputable sources.
That's a highly reputable source.
What do you think about him, though? What do you think they say? He's not my president.
Well, I think they're saying their values aren't reflected in his public policy platform, even one iota, so they're actually correct. He's not their president. He is the president of the people who actually think their values are now going to be on a national level the norm, which is very embarrassing for me as a person who was born in what I feel is the most highest potential to bring all of humanity into a better place. I think that's why people love coming here and being here. And,
come for the food. Oh.
What Trump, I think, represents is the electoral equivalent of white flight, basically.
Do you know anything about this movement to do away with the Electoral College, which is already underway?
Yes, there's an organization.
What's it called, the Compact?
There's an organization called Fair Vote.
But there is another, there is a movement,
yes.
A lot of states, I guess their legislature has voted,
yeah.
And if as soon as enough states to equal 270 electoral college votes vote for this, I guess it'll become law. It doesn't have to be a constitutional amendment.
Who would be their most ideal spokesperson of why the Electoral College needs to be abolished? I'm not trying to be funny here when I say this. I think Hillary would be an outstanding advocate for abolishing the Electoral College. I think she would be able to be in a role that she still is able to be on the scene in a way that she affects public policy in a way that is significant to working class and middle class families, which I don't think when she says that she cares deeply about quality of life of middle class and working class communities, I don't think she's being disingenuous. I just think when you're in that bubble for so long in Washington, D.C., it's like being in a cartel. You don't know that you're in a bubble if all you know is everyone else in D.C. So I think she would be a great person to spearhead that movement. And those organizations are out there. One of them that I'm aware of is called Fair Vote. They have a great website.
I disagree with you on Hillary. I think she would alienate so many. It was real hate or whatever.
Well, that's what I'm saying. This is an opportunity for her to turn over a completely new leaf in a non-senator, non-secretary of state, non-running for president role. And I think there's a lot of misogyny that even if she did. This is the thing that I'm willing to concede also. If same thing with President Obama. If they had enacted policies that had resulted in extraordinarily higher wages and higher literacy rates and less crime and climate change, renewable energy, for some of those folks it still would have never been enough because she's a woman and he's an African American and old bad habits are hard to break. I think no matter what the criticism is, I still feel like I'm hearing on the airwaves, especially on Fox News, a lot of misogyny about her good policies. And to say she doesn't have any good policies at all is just completely dishonest. I don't think she would be a great president or a good president or a mediocre president. But at the same time, I think it's really easy to still bash women in this country when they've reached a level of prominence. And I don't understand that. If things are 50-50 in wages and opportunities for employment, that benefits us all.
Jim.
Trump has been called by many associates the modern-day P.T. Barnum.
Yes.
Can you comment?
Yes, I think that's right on the money. In fact, Yeah, I think P.T. Barnum would love to take a class at Trump University if it actually was a legitimate university where actual instructors or professors actually taught actual information that is usable in the real world to have a job or a skill or even something that would make one's existence more livable.
Okay.
So Donald Trump says he's going to drain the swamp. Now, let's assume that he's even a little bit successful. What are we going to find on the bottom?
Well, let me ask you, what do you think he means when he says drain the swamp?
Well, I think that he wants to find out what's on the bottom and clean that up and then refill it with his own people.
Yeah. I think if you read David K. Johnston's, you'll realize that this is a real operator along the lines of Richard Nixon. They used to call Richard Nixon Tricky Dick for a reason. He could smile right at the masses at a campaign rally and tell them he cared so much about them, and then go into a meeting with one of his people like Ehrlichman or Halderman or Kissinger and just, you know, N-word this and K-word that, and, you know, they wear masks that are very, very convincing. So I'd be very wary of people who are television savvy, new media savvy in the caliber of a Trump, because like Tim said, we're witnessing P.T. Barnum on steroids.
Shall we go to rebuttal now?
Thank you. Charlie, I like it when Charlie
one quick one. I have 35 years experience as a federal government. Do you think I'm more qualified than Trump to be president?
Yes, I do. Unequivocally, that is a yes, sir. With a capital Y, a capital E, and a capital S. I found that quote by Dickens, so I'm going to quote that quote by Dickens from your American Notes real quick. I saw in them the wheels that move the meanest perversion of virtuous political machinery that the worst tools ever wrought. Despicable trickery at elections, underhanded tamperings with public officers, cowardly attacks upon opponents with scurrilous newspapers for shields and hired pens for daggers. Charles Dickens is alive and well in the American psyche in 2016.
All right.
Let's have a big hand for our speaker. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, we'll enter the famous rebuttal period. How many people want to give a rebuttal? Hold up your hands and keep them up. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, and nine back there, ten. Keep your hands up again. And, corner. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. That's 10 people.
All right, I think we can go about 4 minutes.
4 minutes. It'd be about 4 minutes apiece, roughly. So, then we'll wrap it up here about 25 to 9, give our speaker the last final word.
Okay.
All right, first we go. Who's coming up?
Go. All right, first one.
All right. All right.
All right, we the people.
Head up, boys, Tim.
Yeah.
You see, I'm not so fretful about a Trump presidency.
Oh,
you don't know any better.
I am a little bit happy that our Republicans are now in power because they've never really had a chance to enact some good fiscally conservative policies.
Man, dope.
I still believe in limited government.
Smoking dope.
You see, because our next president's going to have four major challenges to deal with. Number one is going to be, give me a second here. Number one is going to be the fiscal deficit that we have to worry about. Two is our infrastructure. Three is our educational system. And four is climate change and energy. Well, let me talk about first about climate change and energy. Could you? The thing that you have to understand about the Republican platform is that if you go and dig a little bit deep into it, there's a little paragraph in there where they support the development of thorium molten salt reactors.
Yes! Yes!
And then what that means is that we all know that wind and solar aren't going to take care of it all. Now, I know Andy and me strongly disagree on this.
Yeah, I know.
But I think it's an all-of-the-above strategy, and I think we can get off fossil fuels. Second, with the development of, we're not the only guys on the block now. And if the United States actively disengages from the world, you know, China's right there, ready for us. Have any of you ever heard of the One Road, One Belt policy?
No.
China is, there was about a few months ago, an event of major importance but of minor newsworthiness was the fact that a train actually went all the way from Shenzhen to the coast of Spain. The containers on it took less than a week, and it went through the entire subcontinent, through Kazakhstan, through Uzbekistan, through Russia, and they're starting to get international shipping going. And right now, they just recently upgraded the Karakoram Highway between the hinterlands of China and I want to say Pakistan. But the Chinese have a little different way of doing it. They don't tie strings to their aid. They don't put, we got to do this with it, we got to do that with it. They let the countries alone, the investors come in, they upgrade the infrastructure, and they just kind of leave it at that. It's sort of a gift to these countries to get going. The other parts, you know, our educational system needs some change too. We got to give more respect for teachers. And let's face it, the world today, you need a post-secondary education of some kind, whether it be a trade school or something else to really go forward. And finally, in the realm of the budget deficits, we got to get smart about where we spend our government money. Are we investing in the future or are we wasting it on further politics? I think the American people, we had basically a bloodless coup in the last election. The American people were tired of perceived of being tired of getting in the shaft and being manipulated by these crony capitalists. I too don't really agree with crony capitalism, but we do have tools that can work that out. And they've been around for 100 years. It's called the Antitrust and Sherman Acts. So, you know, Trump is going to have to realize one thing. Congress is not a board of directors, but I'd still rather be under CEO Trump than Chairman Mao.
That's a false choice.
Thanks, John, for a nice presentation and a fun.
All right.
Let me just make a few comments. As I mentioned in a previous rebuttal, just a couple weeks ago, I think this was the quintessential lesser evil election. Okay. People saw through Hillary Clinton, a lot of people. Even though she maybe had won the election technically, or the number of votes versus the Electoral College, or maybe some stealing of votes going on, but she got a lot of votes, and Trump got a lot of votes. But people saw through Hillary enough to not be enthusiastic to go out and vote for her. So John says, okay, you have an F-plus candidate, and an F-minus candidate. What kind of choice is that? And the thing is, the quote-unquote lesser evil, the F-plus candidate, Hillary Clinton, you know she's an F, okay? Trump, he hasn't been in office. You're not 100% sure that he is that bad. People might be willing to give him a chance. In other words, he's an alternative. Okay, so a lot of people will go with the alternative versus the known evil, okay, like Hillary Clinton. So this is the problem. We have an electoral system where you vote for individuals. You don't vote for on issues. The American people are generally progressive, left to center on issue after issue, but none of those are on the ballot. You have a choice between individuals. So it becomes a personality game. This is why Bernie lost to Hillary. Hillary Clinton swept the South. Why is that? Because she had 80-90% vote totals from the black community. And that's because of her physical, of her person. Not necessarily because of her policies and all that. Bernie was good on policies, but she was associated with Obama, his Secretary of State, and associated with his administration. And also, she's Bill Clinton's wife, and Bill Clinton was thought to be friendly with blacks. He was known as the black candidate in some circles. Okay, so it's a personality contest, and that's the essential problem. That is the problem, voting for Mr. A or Mrs. B or Joe or Jane. This is not us ruling at all. And that's the basic problem. So I think that this election is a great lesson for us to understand that the system, the electoral system, the representative system, is our major problem. And until we get rid of it and replace it with an actual democracy, we are going to continue to go downhill. Because, Trump is definitely going to take it downhill. I think it's foolish for us to expect anything good out of this administration. And in fact, I think we should do everything we can to not allow it to even get on the way.
My name is Raj Patel. I think Hillary Clinton lost have been very, very bad. So I was watching the election, and when Virginia starts shaking, I knew that it's over. Hillary Clinton was a bad candidate. She did not perform well. Her strategy was bad. The people surrounding her was bad. That means not in a sense they were immoral. I think Trump had a immoral candidate, supporters and help. But they were good strategists. And Trump listened to them. And Trump did a very, very good search or a very good strategy in terms of electoral vote. Hillary did not do it. And but that's the way life is. And we have to move on. I hope Trump will do good or bad, because we will find out in about a couple of years whether he screws up international relations and we have lots of trade war, then it will move bad. But all this said and done, it is over. One thing is over. We are not in the moral world. We cannot talk about morality. It's not there. We talk about survival. How we are going to survive? How going to manage our life? How going to make everybody at least food and housing and a reasonable decent life? That is the issue. And it comes morally or immorally. That is what it is. I mean, come on. I can look as far as possible. Rich people always control. Charismatic people always control. I mean, you're not going to find guy or girl who do not have charisma, who do not have intelligence. You know, come on, it doesn't work. And what we should do is that we should have local level leaders, and those leaders have a part and a say in electing a local candidate, in selecting a local candidate. What happened is that over the last 30, 40 years is that we get democratized. And so these people, what Martin Luther King will say is that God will prefer princes no matter how justified their cause than rioting peasants no matter how justified their cause. And that holds. Leadership is a different story than democracy. The democracy, in a way, we have of average person voting on that doesn't work. And the electoral vote, I can understand. But hey, you know, those little states will be nobody. They will not have any say whatsoever if we have a no electoral vote. And the founding fathers were right in doing this thing. But hey, we have to move on new society. It's like a brand new world. We have to move in that. And old world is over. Religion is over. Our thinking and the way we thought is over. The marriage is over. Okay, these all things are over. It's not working. Let's move on. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right.
All right.
All right. All right. All right.
Max.
Going up.
Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead.
All right, why don't you get up there and get a chair?
I'm glad the speaker said something about being duped and said that's kind of pejorative. That made me feel good because I personally have compared myself to Gulliver in Gulliver's Travels.
Yeah.
A gullible person. But I, as the speaker said, maybe I'm not alone. I watched PBS on election night till 1 a.m. and I respect the people on there, Mark Shields, David Brooks, Amy Walters, these sort of people. And they seem to be just as shocked as I was. And if the votes were stolen, it was before 2 a.m. because I went to bed at 1 a.m. and I was quite sure that Donald Trump would win the election. So the other point, or one or two other points I want to make, one is the separation of powers. This was supposed to save us. Well, I guess it failed, because the Supreme Court is going to be to the right, and it appears to me, although we don't know, that the president-elect is going to be to the right, and it appears to me that the Congress is going to be to the right. Where's the separation? The final point is, again, I'm sick of the two parties, to say the least. Amen. And even the Green Party, we heard the Green Party person, Rob Sherman, here a couple weeks ago, and he had no interest in supporting the presidential candidate of his party. So I would think that, in my opinion, the Green Party is not ready for prime time, at least from what I saw. Now, I think Rob Sherman is a very smart guy. He's a great speaker, he's very smooth, but I don't agree with his values, frankly. So anyway, my final point is movement politics. If nothing else, you can get into a group and support some actual values and fight for the candidates who support those values. And when the election is over, you make sure that that person does what they say they were going to do. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah. First, a brief comment on the polling. Everybody says, how could polling be so wrong? Actually, the polling wasn't so wrong. Toward the very, very end, it was within the margin of error. It was 1 or 2% in many, many states, and most of them said for Hillary. It went the other way, but it was very, very close. I think what happened here, and I hear it in this room still tonight, nobody, or a lot of people, the professional politicians on the right side, the Republicans during the primary, and now the Democrats, now that the general is over, the powers that be just never really grasped the anger of a large portion of the American people. There are huge groups of angries. The on the right, they voted for Trump and gave him the nomination. On the left, they voted for Bernie Sanders, who did not get the nomination, but he actually came fairly close. You put those two together and you've got a very, very large block. I think some of the Sanders voters may have actually gone over to Trump, because a lot of their issues were the same, even though Trump is supposedly far to the right. And another factor, I don't have the exact numbers, but I think that the lack of enthusiasm for Hillary Clinton held down the Democratic vote. Maybe somebody here has some more exact figures going back to other elections, and that probably made a difference. We all know the paradigm that for Democrats to win, there has to be high turnout. And there was not particularly high turnout especially on the Democratic side. As far as Trump himself, I guess I'm not as horrified as a lot of my other liberal progressive friends for a number of reasons. I don't think we really know who Trump is. I'm not sure he knows who he is. I think that he has some liberal instincts. He was a Democrat not that long ago, and I think some of that is still there. He's one of the rich people who I think actually does relate to the common man, as the Kennedys did, and as certain other very wealthy, Roosevelt, another excellent example of wealthy people who related to the common people. Yes, he may have been a very rough guy the way he did business occasionally, but if he does in fact take that into foreign affairs, that could be good. However, now as far as being liberal, well, so far I think he may disappoint the conservatives down the road, but as of now he is going. I mean, Sessions for Attorney General is incredible. I don't remember the security advisor, I think his name was General Franklin, do I have that right?
Flynn?
Okay, Flynn, thank you. Used to work for Obama, had a dust up with them and left, accused of being too friendly with the Russians. I don't necessarily love everything that Putin is doing, but I think there is a certain value to being on good terms with your most dangerous enemy. As opposed to being on bad terms,
the Bering Strait bridge
with your worst enemy. I supported Obama, canvassed for him in Iowa and in Indiana, and basically supported him all the way. But he did leave our military in very bad shape. We need to make some improvements there. Possibly, what happened in the Democratic Party will have a good effect in that we may get a third party out of this. I have disliked our two-party system for a long time. I think we should have a system that is more similar to Europe, with a parliamentary and multiple parties, and that could come out of this. Thank you.
All right, we got 4 minutes, and I got three subjects real quick. One is, Well, we've all been watching the presidential elections and the U.S. senators and U.S. reps. Just so everybody knows, ComEd wants to slam through $1 billion increase. Has everybody heard that?
Yeah.
So be ready. You got a chance to call your local folks and say, hell no. So forget these damn Washington folks. Let's talk about the Springfield folks, okay? Please, contact your locals down in Springfield and get this thing stopped.
Otherwise, you'll be paying double. I thought that's what the environments wanted, a smart grid.
And a big thing is, and I'm a green guy all the way, but two failing nuclear things, why should we support the rest? And hell with them. Anyway, the next thing is, Ted, you mentioned about issues-based. I love that because I gave a presentation on 20th of February, 2016, this year, hope you guys go back to it. I'm a big proponent. 4 years, I don't care what your Democrat Republican, it's irrelevant. I want you to list us 30 issues that you're going to knock out. You know why? 10 each year, one each month. Not much too much to ask, is it? It's real simple, Ted. I don't know why we don't do something together, man. I'm serious.
I'll check out your presentation.
This is common sense. This is common sense, Ted. You and me understand it. Thank you. The last thing is electoral college. Does anybody know how many electoral college votes there actually are?
435.
No.
535.
No. Keep going.
538.
Did I hear 538? 538. You know how we get these numbers?
House plus the Senate.
Yeah, and it's not the actual House and Senate people, but it's electors, the number.
Right, right.
So we got 435 in the House, 100 in the Senate, and guess where the other three come from?
D.C.
Huh?
D.C.
Yeah, Washington, D.C. And guess what? It's the 22nd Amendment. Guess what everybody wants to know about that, too. So 538, that's where you get the number 270. So if you add 269 and 269, that's 238. It's a tie, right? And then it goes to the House of Representatives or the Senate, I don't know which one, but then they vote. But if it goes to 270, the electors have spoke. And just so you know, it's the television folks that are predicting the winner. Because they don't have all the precincts in and all across the country at one time. All they're doing is just trying to give you the most likely candidate that's going to win. So that's there. And December 19th is the actual vote that these electors give their vote. And January 16th is when it's officially announced across the country. And then January 20th is when the president takes over. The problem with this system is, I can go into, how long, much time do I have?
You got about less than 45 seconds.
Yeah, 45 seconds left.
The problem with this system is 24 states say popular vote in our state takes all the electorates. You can, and literally, it's a law, you cannot change your mind. But Thomas Jefferson in 1801 to 1809, he didn't want that. He wanted the freedom of electors to vote whoever they want. If Gene was up there, they wanted the electors to say, hell no for Gene. I don't care what the country voted for. I want Gene out. But unfortunately, we have 24 states that you can't do it. I wish I could go on and on and on, but I got 4 minutes. Thanks.
All right. We're getting a real political science.
All right. Next.
Real lesson. I'm taking notes.
Next.
Yeah, that's correct. I was going to bring that up, but I don't think it was adequately mentioned here. There is actually movement to try to get some of the electors to change their votes by December 19th. And there's a petition. There's several going around, I think. I happened to get an email about one of them. But I started to sign, and then, of course, I'm always reluctant to have my name out there. It's really scary.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm concerned about talking here, because this videotape will be out on the internet. And so-called faithless electors are electors who change their vote. It is legal for them to do so in some states. Some states have it mandatory that they vote for whoever got the popular vote in their state. But in many cases, there's no retribution on them, or there's just a minor fine. So many of these electors, something like a $1,000 fine, which is chicken feed, as Trump would say. So many of these electors could change their votes, especially in states like Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, which were very close, and which are, Pennsylvania not so much so, but Michigan and Wisconsin, which are very suspect because of the large shift in the vote from the polls, which was more than the number of points that it shifted from the polls in states like North Carolina and Florida. So those are very, very suspicious to me. Allegations, Mr. Anderson brought those up about the possibility that that these vote counts were hacked one way or the other, and that it's not even mentioned in the main media, the corporate media. This is a very scary thing. Hillary Clinton doesn't want to go there. Many of us hoped that she would fight a little more. It's fine to say, to have said that, the vote counts as they are now do favor Mr. Trump, but why don't we have an investigation into what happened to provisional ballots, for example? That wasn't brought up here. Jonathan, you did a very, very great talk. You were very witty, clever, in your main presentation. But if this is to be a serious discussion here, which we had a good amount of serious discussion, if we could get enough electors to change their votes, Trump will not be the president. Hillary Clinton would be. The House of Representatives would have no say in it, absolutely. If 270 electors were to vote for Hillary Clinton on December 19th, we would be saved the worry, the substantial worry, that Mr. Trump, being such an autocrat and such an obviously uncontrollable person in his temperament and in what he might do, on the occasion that unforeseen events might occur. We know there was a large terrorist attack on this country at one point, and we know that ISIS loves the fact that Trump is the president-elect, and they may be awaiting the opportunity to make a terrorist attack, which would possibly give Trump the ability or the inclination to instigate curbs on our personal liberty and especially things like roundup liberals like me. So I'm very concerned about that. I don't want to be in panic mode, but I really despair at the normalization of Trump, even in this august company here. I was hoping for a little more urgency and concern about the definite dangers to our republic or democracy, whichever word you want to use, and our civil liberties possibly being destroyed by this maniac that was very disturbed person, psychologically disturbed perhaps, that could be taking office January 20th.
All right, I'll be very quick. Thank you, we the people, for your packets of information and your charts. I know you did some expenditure of the time and effort you put into a very informative. I'll be very quickly here. Let's pretend that you are a union representative of federal employees. And we often have cases called merit staffing cases. And then in this instance, we have a case of two competing applicants for promotion to a position. Now we have one candidate, one applicant, who has 30 years of credible government service, has a clean record, and no formal disciplinary actions taken. Now the other applicant has zero experience at all as an applicant. So we've got 30 years versus. Now the one applicant is accused, there is something that the one applicant is accused of misusing her emails. The other applicant, I need to remind you, has never sent even one government email. And has yet to ever send one. Nevertheless, we've got basically a tourist who has been a tourist to Washington who is going to become president of the United States. And it's rather disconcerting that, as you answered, I'm more qualified to be president of the United States than the person we're going to inaugurate. Now that should cause you some concern, boys and girls. But nevertheless, thank you very much. Let's move on. Really, that was very good. I enjoyed it completely. Thank you. Come again.
Can I make one statement? I knew you would appreciate. This is my grandfather, John Missouri.
New York Central.
He moved from Europe, Poland, to Chicago in 1901 and got a job on the railroad. And Charlie, I wanted you to see a picture, the one picture I have of my great-grandfather, John Mazurek, in the circa 1920s.
Okay.
He worked on the south side.
All right.
Wow. Good job, Charlie.
All right.
Okay, I'll keep this short because I'm going to catch a bus that's coming in 6 minutes. Well, thanks be the people for a pretty lively presentation and all your effort on the back, and I'm looking forward to looking at all this propaganda you gave us, you know, over the coming days. Even though I disagree with a lot of what you said, I do have to give you an A for effort, though, for putting everything together. Now, I don't know if you heard it this week, though, but the 2017 fashion outlook for women has come out. I don't know how many of you heard it, but what's out is pantsuits. And what's in is nothing.
Mini skirts.
If you get that, you might have to think about it for a few minutes. So anyway, the electoral vote. If you look at a map of the United States, the electoral map, 2016 electoral map, by county, you will see that this is clearly the United States of Trump. This was such a landslide. It's ridiculous. I mean, you look at virtually every county, like 8 or 9 out of 10 counties went for Trump. And this is why we have the electoral system. This is a republic, not a democracy. The founders were very worried about mob rule and having just a few large population centers
you know, run all the other states roughshod. I mean, when they formed the union and they wanted to get all the states together, the smaller states were worried. Like, well, we want to have a say in something too. We don't want to just get, you know, run roughshod by these,
they,
you know,
wanted to
large
protect slavery.
So they, you know, we came up with the electoral system, which works because, you know, you look at the Senate, good. And even a small state has an equal say in the Senate. And the same thing now with selecting the president. You know, small states, you know, like, so Wyoming, sure, they have three electoral votes, you know, with their small population. But in California has 55. Like I brought up, though, a great many of those are based on illegal aliens that shouldn't even be, not only should they not be here, but they certainly shouldn't be counted as part of the electoral system. But the thing is, you have to win an awful lot of Wyomings to overcome, you know, one California. But that's what Trump did. And it's, so it shows broad-based appeal. Not just somebody that won the coasts and, you know, a couple other liberal cities, Austin and, you know, a couple college towns. But I mean, but people that have broad-based appeal, north to south, east to west, and that is certainly Trump, you know, the, you know, flyover country, is what the liberals call it. So, how much time do I have left?
You got about a minute and a half.
Okay. I would make changes to the electoral system, but again, what I would do is get rid of this business where, you know, count illegal aliens count towards the population. And the other thing, of course, I would start doing right away is working on repealing or amending the 14th Amendment to end birthright citizenship. It's about time we end that. It's disastrous. Illegal aliens come over here, drop an anchor, baby. They're unskilled. I mean, we've been having this invasion of unskilled immigrants coming in. They don't earn enough money to pay for the health, education, and welfare of their offspring, and the taxpayers get stuck with it. We got $20 trillion in debt already. We've got to cut it off. So I'll let it go at that, and I'm working on my next speech. I don't know what it's going to be yet, but there'll be an announcement soon.
What about that immigrant in that photo?
Oh yeah, by the way, I got one quick thing. One of my great-grandfathers came over in 1901 and worked on the New York Railroad as well. Awesome. Came over from Italy.
Yeah,
and then set for my great-grandmother in 1902.
Maybe we should have some high-speed rail for all those unemployed American workers. Not so much military spending.
Next, Andy, you're going to go next?
All right, Bob.
Okay, 4 minutes.
On the last one, I guess, the 10th one.
Where are you going?
Okay, I got a timer, Andy. Don't worry about it.
Thank Jonathan for a tremendous packet of information that he put together. He's obviously spent months researching this. It was a great presentation on a bunch of different issues. It's hard to cover something like this in one night, but I think we should give him a big hand.
Inexplicable.
I've been quoting Captain Kirk from the original Star Trek for the last 9 months or so. He used to open the program saying, "Our 5-year mission is to go where no man has gone before." Well, that's where we are. We're in virgin territory, and people are constantly waking up after these stolen elections saying, how could people be so stupid to vote this way? Why are Americans so dumb? It hit the high point in 2014 when the newspapers reported how the Congress had an approval rating of about 9%, you know, slightly lower than whale shit. And the paper said, why do we keep voting these criminal Congress people back in? Why don't American people are so stupid? Why don't they vote them out? Well, that's what that book Code Red talks about. They shifted the votes to red for 89 of those people that got voted out in 2014. It was a red computer shift after people went to bed. And so what should be a solidly controlled, democratically controlled Congress was still in the hands of the Republican criminals, or criminals masquerading as Republicans, is the way to put it. These Republicans aren't like Eisenhower's Republicans. There's an article by Tom Hartman. It came out in about 2013. Tom did the research all the way from Eisenhower's time, and he quoted Lyndon Johnson talking to Everett Dirksen. in 1968 when Richard Nixon was trying to get elected. And the dirty tricks that Nixon was involved in, trying to make a deal with the people in Vietnam to, I'll give you a better deal if you elect me. Johnson said to Everett Dixon, he said, they ought not to be doing this. This is treason. And Everett Dixon said, well, if we expose the American public the fact that our politicians are involved in treason, it's going to shatter their confidence in the whole system. Well, Cartman goes through an analysis of all the Republicans that have held the White House up through George W. Bush. And he said, since Eisenhower, there has been no Republican holding the White House that wasn't involved in massive treason against the American people to get into the office in the first place. That's where we are. And the first step, teach seventh graders, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem. The problem is that we're voting for criminals, that only 20% of the public, what I call the zombie vote, rises off the couch and heads the polls like the Night of the Living Dead. Those are the Rush Limbaugh's ditto heads, the people that are Fox News watchers. That's about 20% of the public. The other 80% is trying to do the right thing, but they don't know, and they don't know that about 10 million Democratic voters, the numbers are coming in now, roughly 10 million voters were kept from casting a vote, or they were given provisional ballots. They were disenfranchised in huge numbers at this election. That's one of the reasons that they say it was close and Trump got more. Okay? So start using the correct language. Trump wasn't elected. He was installed with criminal activity.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Speaker gets the last word. Get up there.
Speaker gets the last word, Jonathan.
Where's the hat, man? Come on.
Yeah.
I'm not in this one.
This is Jonathan.
Boring. I'm a mild-mannered reporter from the Daily Planet right now. Slim Brodnich says in the very first quote of his book, Bughouse Square to the Beat Generation, for those of you who don't know, Slim founded the college. I was in the clink in 1919 for being a wobbly. I was run out of town in Red Bluff, California for being broke. I wore chains in El Paso and stripes in St. Augustine for the same reason. I've been investigated by all the law, from the ward healer to the FBI, for running the forum where free speech is guaranteed to all. Brother, I know what the police state is. You know, just to answer some of your concerns, yeah, that is absolutely right on the money. He's been installed. That's what we're listing, installment. On the other point about immigrants, we're told that the military-industrial complex is off limits to talk about. One of the reasons is they don't audit it. You know, they audit apparently imaginary people who are voting, who they say are immigrants, because it's good news. I don't think immigrants are the detriment to the American workforce or the vitality of our country. I think it's the reason why we are leading in so many different areas despite our failed leadership in government. I also think that there are a lot of simple things like ranked choice voting. And just for a small victory this electoral season, the voters of Maine voted for ranked choice voting so they can vote for their most popular candidate, their second popular candidate, and their least popular candidate, so there's no spoilers. So Maine is now the example of how to avoid at least some of the deficiencies in our almost sunk system, but still a little bit over water, and a lot of people are finding that grassroots action for voter reform is their lifeboat. As far as Trump is concerned, I think somebody said he's a little bit liberal. people before he got into office really liked Reagan because they said he was a great communicator, and they really liked George H.W. Bush because he was such a great Christian, and they liked George W. Bush because you could have a beer with him. So don't believe what the media image is of someone when their policy platform says that your community can be sold to the highest bidder, because that's dangerous. Also, to someone's point that we should be more sober in our comments and not so light, I had the opportunity with my father, he worked at Family Lab here at CERN and DAISY in Europe. I had the opportunity, the privilege to be in Europe for 3 years as a young child. And one of the things when you're in Germany, you learn about the history of fascism firsthand from people who were grandchildren of people who survived that time where they lived under a fascist dictator in Italy and Germany. Sophie Scholl and Hans Scholl should be read, their story and their courage and their bravery. And I'm paraphrasing Chris Hedges, but he says, I don't fight fascists because I'm going to win. I fight fascists because they're fascists. That's what I think all of us are on a very sober note right now, preparing ourselves for in our grassroots mobilizations of understanding that the surveillance state, the police state, the incarceration state. They actually suggested, one of his advisors the other day, the Japanese internment camps during the Roosevelt administration was a model that could be used as if they were talking about a legitimate policy decision of sane human being adults. So that was kind of shocking and just disgusting for him to suggest that. Crony capitalism. Yeah, it's the capitalism, stupid. How many times do we have to hear from other countries that it doesn't have to be like this? We're like a vehicle, our civic equivalent of a vehicle has stone wheels that are square, and we go backwards with our eyes closed, with our hands not on the steering wheel. We're able to handle complexity and nuance in this country to learn how other parliamentary governments have an engaged citizenry. We could be the greatest democracy in the world if we just learn some of those lessons and don't say, well, it's not our idea first, therefore it's a non-starter. That's an infantile response, and I hope we're not being groomed by this new president installer or installee to be infantile, because it's time to be adults and realize that this is the electoral equivalent of white flight, and we're going to see a lot of our brothers and sisters in oppressed communities who need our solidarity now more than ever. John Lennon once said, when it gets down to having to use violence, then you're playing the systems game. The establishment will irritate you, pull your beard, flick your face, and make you fight, because once they got you violent, then they know how to handle you. The only thing they don't know how to handle is nonviolence and humor. So I just want to finish with this brief poem. A liar is elected and the truth is rejected. We're the architects of our own demise. It should be expected when this much money is connected. Promises will be compromised. Many mobilize in the next 4 years like our lives depend on it, and the future of our climate, of our planet depend on it, and be always cognizant that a new day is as close as our will to be free as humans, not just as Americans. Happy 2016 Electoral Migraine!
Attention, please. One final note. The restaurant asked to make sure everybody takes all their personal belongings with them. So there, people have been leaving some things here, and somebody left a laptop computer here a week or two ago. So they don't want the responsibility for that stuff. So clean up your tables and take all your personal stuff with you. Thank you.
She's a nurse.
On a final note from P.T. Barnum, there's a sucker born every minute, and every crowd has a silver lining. We're adjourned.
Yeah, very, very important.